My name is April Hall. I'm from Great Falls, Montana, and our issue is with family court corruption. Okay, my granddaughter, October, who was my son's child, her mother moved in with David Hyslop. Hyslop is what they called him. I met him, and it was Hyslop, whichever you want to call him. And right after that, I started noticing every time I had my granddaughter, she would have bruises or scratches, or, and a lot of them, when I was supposed to go pick her up, the mother would call me minutes before I was going to get her and say, well, October did this. One time, like, her lips were all cut and the inside of her mouth was cut, but I don't know what happened. And I don't know how many times that happened. All the time that was happening. And then in January, my son got to come home on leave from Afghanistan. And we got October. We were supposed to have her for while my son was home. And that night, I went to pick October up. And her mother was actually going to come with me to the airport also to pick my son up. Only, I don't know what was going on in that house. I don't know. The door opened. The other lady living there threw October out to me with not even her coat on. It was dead of winter. So I got her and put her in my car, and pretty soon the mom comes out. She says, just keep her because I'm moving out of here, and just keep her until I can get out of here. So I thought, okay, fine, because I had to get to the airport. My son was coming in from Afghanistan, strapped her in, and away we went. And we had her for several days, and then all of a sudden the grandmother called us because she went in and took the little boy, October's half brother, took him out of the house because I called her and kind of told her what was going on, and she had the police go there to get the little boy back and told the mother to call us and tell us the sheriff was coming to get October if we didn't willingly bring her back. And let me tell you, that was the hardest thing you have to do, knowingly putting her back in a house where you know this violence is going on. And so what could we do? You know, we didn't have a custody. It was in the makings because my son wasn't on the birth certificate yet. And we were trying to get that all taken care of, to get my son on the birth certificate. And every time we'd go, it was, oh, I can't find my ID or this and that to file the court papers. So after we dropped October off, I went home and I called Family Services, and that was January 16th of 2011.
Let me stop you just a second.
Okay.
So October was born to your son and a woman named what?
Christy Perez.
Okay. And they weren't married?
No.
And was he in Afghanistan when the child was born?
No. He was home. He was in Great Falls.
Was he at the hospital?
No, because she was married, actually, and she was trying to cover it up. So it was a fight from the get-go. And I knew October was my son's because she looked just like the babies in my family, the blue eyes and little toe head or bald head. So I knew. But she was trying, and her husband was Hispanic, and she is dark too, and you don't have blonde haired, blue eyes babies, you know. Or as I explained it to the detective, that Hispanics don't have Norwegian babies. That's what I said, and that's how I knew. That's how I knew.
And was there ultimately a paternity test?
Yes, there was. Actually, we did that before she called was going to call the sheriff on us. I made the arrangements while my son was still in Afghanistan, actually. And just a couple days after he got home, my son Michael, the mother Christy, and October went to, I think it's called Identigene, and they had the work done, and it was proven that October was his.
Okay. So
yes, and that was in January
of 2011.
Okay. Yes.
So, married woman.
Right.
Gets involved with your son.
Right.
They produce October.
Right.
Paternity test establishes that it's his.
And even before the paternity test was done, she acknowledged I was the grandmother and Michael was the father.
But his name was not on the birth certificate.
Nope. And so I called Family Services, and then of course she got very mad because Family Services went in the home to do a few checks. And then I wasn't allowed to see October again. And my son, of course, had to go back to Afghanistan because he was only on a two-week leave. But in the meantime, her mother snuck October out to see me. It was like January 26th or something. And her face, October's face, was full of scratches. I don't know what happened. It looked like somebody just went like this down her face, and it was full of scratches. And then a few days later, of course, she finally consented that, yeah, I could keep her for the weekend again. And that's when I actually had to go pick October up at Christy's mother's house, the other grandmother, because Christy didn't want to see me. And she didn't get there, so I waited and waited, and Grandma went and got her. And I knew something was wrong immediately because October was crying. I mean, it was, you can tell a cry on a baby when it's just them throwing a fit and when it's painful. So I got her in the car seat. My mom was with me, and we went home. We were supposed to go out to eat because every Friday night my family does that so we can see each other. And I called those, and I said, you know, October is really crying hard. I think I'm just going home. So I got her home, and I, trying to get her out of the car seat, she'd just scream her head off, and I tried to get her coat off her, and she was screaming. Finally, I called the other grandma. I said, you know, I said, what happened? I said, did she say what's wrong with October? I said, something's wrong here. Well, I'll call her. So Christy calls me back. I said, Christy, what happened? I said, there's something wrong. She can't hold her cup, you know, with both hands. She can't use her hand. I tried to feed her because I thought, you know. Oh, well, I don't know. I said, well, I'm coming to get you. And I said, we're going to the emergency room. No, no, no. Wait till tomorrow. I said, no. I said, I'm coming to get you, and we're going to the emergency room right now. So I dropped my mom off, and I went and picked Christy up. And when we got to the emergency room, I mouthed in the background to the lady at the desk. I said, please call Family Services. And we got back into the room, and she kept going out to smoke cigarettes. So I was sitting there with October by myself most of the time and waiting to decide what they were going to do. So she got back in there, and in the meantime, they had come to get October to go do x-rays, and she was outside smoking cigarettes again, so I went back with them. And they did the x-rays and found that her arm was broken. So we went back in the little room, and Christy came back, and we were sitting there, and we were just sitting there waiting because they were going to come and put the little cast on her. And the doctor sent, I don't know if she was a nurse or somebody from the front office, to come and get me. And they took me into this little room and asked me, what, you know, why did you want Family Services to come? And I said, well, I've reported it already before. And I said, you know, something's fishy here because Mama didn't want me to bring her that night. I don't know what she was up to. So Family Services came up and took October, and I took her home. I had emergency custody of her then for 5 days. The next day, Rachel Zins, who was the caseworker, called me and said, you have to bring her up to the clinic and go to Nancy Maynard, and she's going to look at her. So my daughter and I brought her up there, and she looked at her and then went and ordered a full body x-ray. So we took her back there, and she did that. And they found the other arm had been broken, just, you know, not in two, but it is already starting to heal. So we brought October back home, and then the next morning I had to bring her to Dr. Pike, who is a bone orthopedic doctor. And the caseworker and the mother met me there at that office, and I wasn't allowed to go back there. And then I got to bring October back to my house again. And later that day, Rachel Zins, the caseworker, called me and told me herself, the county attorney, and her supervisor had a meeting and decided there was not enough evidence to keep October out of the house. So I had 20 minutes to get her back to family services to return her to her mother.
I'd like you to repeat that and name each of the people and their positions as you do it. In other words, Rachel Zins, a caseworker for
okay.
Department of Children and Families, or whatever it's called.
Okay.
The county attorney, let's name them all.
Okay.
Give their positions, so if you don't mind.
Okay. Rachel Zins, who was the caseworker in October's case, and I believe her supervisor she was talking about was Rod Hausman, I think is how you say his name, and the county attorney for Great Falls or Cascade County is John Parker.
And what did they do?
They supposedly had a meeting and decided there wasn't enough evidence to keep October out of the home. However, after October passed away, I talked to the county attorney, and he told me that meeting never took place. He said the only time he ever heard October mentioned is when she died, and it came to the county attorney's office. And he went back and checked to make sure nobody in his office had heard anything about that in February, and nobody had. So that was just a flat lie from the Rachel Zins.
How do you spell Zins?
Z-I-N-S.
Okay. And she works for, what's it called here in Montana?
I don't know. I hear it called, I always call it Child and Family Services, but apparently that's not, I don't know. They have different names. I don't know what.
DCF.
Yeah.
Department of Children
and Family Services. That's, yeah.
Department of Family Services?
Department of Family Services, I think, yeah.
Everyone can say
DFFs. I know, it changes all the time.
All right, so Rachel Zins tells you, when was this?
That was in February, when the beginning of February.
February 2011. She yep. tells you that there's a meeting held.
Yep.
And there wasn't enough evidence to do anything, and the child
right.
had to go back to the house where she had...
Right.
Come from.
And then I'm going to tell you later on, when we got the medical records, both doctors, Dr. Pike and Dr. Maynard, both stated in there that they were probably, they were suspicious and probably not accidental. And it was in both records.
All right, so... Rachel Zinn tells you a meeting takes place.
Right.
You've later been told by someone who it might have been in his best interest to say it didn't take place, but who claims it did.
Right.
Pointing another finger at Rachel Zinn's, that even though she had two doctors giving her reports that these accidents probably were not accidental.
Right.
That the child obviously had a broken arm that had never been cared for. She's taken to the emergency room with another arm broken. You are able to report picking her up when her face is scratched, and you are obviously aware that there's abuse going on, or you strongly suspect.
Yeah, they didn't want to look at my pictures. I told her we have pictures and
photos.
Yep, they didn't want to see them.
And with all of that information, they send the child back into that
right.
home.
Right.
Let me get you to say that, because I want to throw all that in there,
yeah.
All the information that they had or that you offered to give them that they ignored. Would
yes.
you do that as a soundbite for me?
Sure. I had lots of pictures of October with bruising. She had the evidence from the x-rays. One arm was broke and one was already broken and healing. And the county attorney, Rachel Zins, and the supervisor decided, even after I saw those records, and it says right in them, the doctor records, that it was probably non-accidental because the mother couldn't explain them, and they still put the child back in the home. And then, of course, then I couldn't see her again. Because of this, the mother wouldn't let me see her again. Until finally I decided the end of March. I thought, you know, this is my granddaughter and I can't find anything out. I called Rachel. She was supposed to give us updates, and they were working in the home with them for 3 hours a week since she was returned with a broken arm up until the time I called and a little out. It was through part of the month of April. They were supposedly working in the home. I don't know who it was, somebody from Family Services or somebody they hired to do that. I have no idea. But in the meantime here, then when I got to see her in April, she's missing all the hair off the top of her head and one of the teeth, and they're working in the home with her.
Okay, let me stop you. Who all lived in that home?
It was Christy.
Okay.
Who all lived in the home was Christy, the mother, her boyfriend, David Highslope, who eventually killed October, David Highslope's brother, Kendall, and his girlfriend, Janetta, and two big dogs, and October's half-brother for part of up until the beginning of April when I took him to the airport and put him on a plane to his dad. And let me tell you, the house was, it probably wasn't much bigger than this room we're filming in. And then the basement was the same size, and all these people and a dog were in there.
Under 1,000 square feet.
Maybe. Right. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Definitely. Because I think we looked it up on the internet when you, and it was, I don't even know if it was 900 feet. Yeah. So.
That was 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 children, 6 people, sorry.
Yeah. And two
four
big
adults,
dogs.
2 children and 2 big dogs.
Right. In a 1-bedroom house, because the basement really, I don't know, I think there was 2 rooms down there, but it wasn't finished or anything. Right. And that's where they were, down in the basement with crumbling walls that were leaking water, and I know they were because we had a wet spring. Yes. But, so then in April, when we discovered, when we got to meet with them, in October had hair missing and a tooth missing and stunk like marijuana so bad and was filthy. I'm talking, under her fingernails was just black. Her coat was black, just filthy. We met for lunch.
What did the hair, do you have photos of this?
Yes, I do.
Can we see? What did you make of the hair situation?
Well, she tried to convince me there was something medically wrong.
The mother.
The mother did. And so we did, actually, we took her to, she had blood work done, and we took her to her doc, well, she's not a doctor, she's a, nurse practitioner. Yeah. And they did blood work, and she looked at her and couldn't find anything wrong. There's my poor baby with a broken arm. Right here is, you can see all the hair is gone off the top of her head, and a tooth is missing.
Turn that around us.
I was just trying to take a picture out so you can.
Well, they took pictures of it, and you can see here that whole patch is gone off the top of her head, and here she's got a tooth missing. Can you get that one? It's this one. You can see the big patch of hair missing. And then here her tooth is missing.
And how old was she at this time?
About 2.5. Well, 2 years and 4 months, yeah.
All right. Could I get you to say that again? October was 2
October was 2 years old, 2 years and 4 months old in these pictures. So it was, when we met her, it was myself, my sister, my mother, and my daughter. And so, of course, after the meeting, then they went home and we went home and we called family services again, myself and my sister. And she really didn't seem concerned. Rachel Zins, the caseworker, it was like she had no concern about it at all. I said, you guys are working in the home and, you know, you didn't go make her go to the dentist or anything. So that, and she was just, she was rude to us both on the phone, my sister who called and myself. So we decided we're going in there. We're just going to go to family services office. And of course, we got there and asked if we could speak to Rachel Zins and the lady at the desk, and I don't know her name. She was very rude to us. Do you have an appointment? We said, no. Well, then you're going to have to sit and wait. And we said, fine. So we went and waited. And in the meantime, all this, I kept telling my sister, I just don't like that caseworker. She's not professional. She doesn't listen to your concerns. And Rachel comes out, and my sister's like, oh, my God, April, I know her. I worked with her. And I thought, oh, thank God. Now maybe she'll listen. Well, that didn't happen. So we did. We went in and had at least a half-hour chat, and I told her, I had already told Mother, I said, I will pay for a dentist visit, because in the meantime, I actually work for a dentist, and I talked to him about it, and he said, April, two-year-olds don't lose their teeth. He said, you get, try to get her in here, because he said, we would be able to tell you right away what happened. Well, of course.
The name of the supervisor you met with?
No, this was with Rachel Zins, the caseworker herself we met with there. Yeah, Rachel Zins. So I told the mother, Christy, and I told Rachel Zins both, you know, make an appointment. And then it was, well, she's on Medicaid, so she has to go to Helena. I said, well, I'll drive her to Helena. Nope, you know, let's just get her to a dentist, because this was my hope. Because maybe, you know, maybe this was it and we could get her out of there. Well, that didn't happen. Didn't happen. And like I said, Family Services was supposedly working 3 hours a week in the home from the time she was returned to Christy with the broken arms through part of the month of April. And the tooth was missing and the hair was missing, and they didn't make her do anything. They just didn't think it was a big deal. So then, of course, I tried to get October through the whole month, and it was always one thing after another with her. She lost her ID, so we couldn't go take care of the paperwork, because I was my son's power of attorney. And we were trying to get as much paperwork done so when he got home, we could hopefully get her out of there. And, of course, that didn't happen.
Let me ask about the tooth. Were you able, with her at a time, were you able to look to see if it looked like it was broken in there?
Or? Oh, no, the whole tooth was gone.
Whole tooth was
the
gone.
Whole tooth was gone. Okay. Yep, the whole tooth was gone. So I went back and forth with the mother the whole month of April, and we did get to see her again on April 20th because it was my birthday on the 19th, and I said, you know, can I take you guys? Can you come out for dinner? And we did do that, and that was the last time I saw October because she was served with paperwork from the lawyer to try to get a parenting plan. And it made her angry, and that was it. She wouldn't talk to me again. She wouldn't let me see October again.
Again, what date was that?
That was the end of it. It was probably around like April 25th or something like that when she was served paperwork.
How many grandchildren do you have?
October was my only one.
No. And wait till
I... Okay. October was my only grandchild. So we, my sister and I made calls to family services after that, during that time, trying to still get her into a dentist. Because my dentist assured me they would be able to say what happened. Then the beginning of June, it must have been about June 3rd, Christy's husband, she's still married to him, by the way, Christy's husband called me and told me, Christy sent me these Well, I have the pictures there, these pictures that she wanted him to show the little boy of his sister. And she also told me, April, there's three teeth missing now, because he knew there was one tooth. So I called the lawyer, and he wrote Rod Houseman and Rachel Zins a letter and sent the pictures. And I called Rachel and talked to her, and I called Central Intake. I called the police and had a welfare check. That was on June 6th. The lawyer, like I said, sent letters. My sister called Rachel and Central Intake. My son called Rachel from Afghanistan, and the half-brother's father called Rachel Zins. And nothing was done. She said, case closed. That's it. Nothing was done. So by that time, we were just praying. You know, our hands were tied. We didn't have any legal rights. The lawyer was trying to get the parenting plan, because in my power of attorney, it stated that I had family rights for my son, medical family rights, able to work with the lawyer. And unfortunately, we were just praying, because he was to be home by the end of August from Afghanistan, and we figured at that point, you know, we could get her out of there immediately as soon as he was there. And unfortunately, that didn't happen. I went to Chicago for my niece's graduation on June 17th. We left and went to Chicago, went to my niece's graduation, my mother and two of my sisters and I. And we always wanted to go to New York, so we figured we were that far, we'd go spend a couple days in New York, come back to Chicago, pick my mother up, and head back home. Unfortunately, on the 23rd of June, in New York City, I got a phone call from Christy's mother, Jamie Phipps. She told myself that October fell and bumped her head in the basement, and her mother was right there. Her mother was right there. And immediately I knew I was calling family services, because they were bringing her to the emergency room for a bump falling in the basement. So I handed my phone off to my sister, who talked to Jamie, and Jamie told her October fell and bumped her head on the sidewalk, and her mother was right there. And I grabbed my other sister's phone, and we called Central Intake and told them. And of course, by that time, a nurse from the emergency room already had called them and told them, this is child abuse. Get somebody up here. So when we were done on the phone with Family Services and Jamie, I called my daughter, who was in Great Falls, and my sister called her daughter, who is a nurse in Great Falls, and told them to get up to the emergency room, because something's going on with October. And so they both went up there, and my niece called my sister back and told her that she better prepare Auntie April, because October wasn't going to make it. And this was like, oh my God, all she did was fell and bumped her head, you know. How did this happen? And they didn't know what to do with her at the emergency room. It was bad. So they sent her to the Children's Hospital in Salt Lake. And basically they kept her alive for a couple days, because they harvest some of her organs. And she, when they turned off the machine, she passed away on the 25th of June. We have some of the information of what was wrong with her. Or, unfortunately, during the trial for David Hyslop, they made my family leave the courtroom when they were doing the autopsy reports. And I couldn't go to court because they had me testify. So I had to sit there while the court was gone for a week and a half, and I didn't get to go in there only to testify. But in the what my family did get to hear, both of October's big toes had been broken. Both of her little toes were broken. She had a broken back, actually, at least a week prior to the broken back that killed her. And she would have been in excruciating pain. She had a hematoma on her head. And she was full of bruises. And the reason I know that is we took pictures of her, saw her at the funeral home. And they had makeup on her, a quarter of an inch thick, and you could see all the bruising through the makeup. And it was totally preventable. It's the saddest part of the whole thing. It was totally preventable. Totally. It's just nobody would listen. David Hyslop is in Deer Lodge, Montana right now. He was sentenced to 100 years without the possibility of parole. The other three adults in the house, you can't tell me they didn't know something was wrong, because she had all this stuff that was healing. So it had happened prior to, nothing has happened to them yet. And I don't know if anything will. Actually, the day it happened, it happened at least 3 hours prior to the mother calling an ambulance. Because the brother said, Kendall Hyslop, David's brother, said he heard three solid smacks coming out of the basement. And he went down there to see what happened, and his brother told him, just go upstairs. October, I don't know what some excuse he gave her, but he'll take care of it. And in the meantime, the mother gets home. Supposedly, I don't know. I still believe she was in the house. And they go get a food basket from I don't know where they picked them up, a food basket, and left October down there dying with all these injuries, and went and got a food basket. The mother and the boyfriend. And then they went home and cuddled. That's what she said in court. We went home and cuddled. With October laying 10 feet probably from their bed, dying. They showed videos of the house. And I don't know how anyone from Family Services could have possibly stepped foot in that house and left a child in there. There were 7 pot plants in the house. And they didn't see them, apparently, either. But the reasoning behind that I got is one of the adults had a marijuana card in the house, so it was okay for that and okay for them kids to smell like marijuana. The house was filthy. I think it was a police officer, a female police officer, that filmed. And she said it was deplorable and just about couldn't stay in there because of the smell. There, October slept on a broken bed frame with a ripped up mattress with no sheet by the washer and dryer, by the furnace with an open flame, with clothes stacked a foot at least on the floor, dirty diapers laying all over with feces in them. Her bed was right beside the floor drain for the sewer. And supposedly, Rachel Zins went down there, and that was fine for her to be sleeping down there. That's what she told us. It was fine. So I don't know how. I honestly believe they didn't go check. I think they went to the upstairs of the house, and that's it. They didn't go check to see where those kids were sleeping. And my sister, Mary Librand, actually, a few weeks ago, she stopped by that house, and the people had just left all the pig mess and moved out. The brother, Kendall, and the girlfriend who were still living there. And there was a man there remodeling the house. Personally, I think it needs to be bulldozed in. And he was telling her, and she got to go in and witness, there were maggots in the fridge. He had to pour two bottles of bleach on the floor downstairs, and somebody had been using the floor drain for a toilet. And keep in mind, October slept right by it. Her bed was right there over the floor drain. And the house still smelled so bad you couldn't stand. He said it was hard for him to sleep or to work in there. The cupboards had this much filth down the front of them. The bathroom, the toilet was totally black, and he had already ripped the shower out because the walls were so filthy. And all the walls in the house had from, I don't know, it was just brown runs down the wall and little brown beads all over everything in the house. And that's where family services went and checked, and it was all right for those kids to be there. And I don't know. I just don't know. I don't know what else to say. It just makes me sick to think about it. And like I told the county attorney, because I have a cleaning business and my granddaughter died in that filth. So,
had you ever had any, let me ask this. What was your impression of the government prior to all this happening?
Well, you know, I really didn't have any, because we didn't have to deal with anything involving them, because nothing, you know, other than my son being in the Army, in the Army Reserve. And they always treat him good. They treated, you know, all the people in the service good. My daughter actually has a degree in criminal justice, and she works, she's a compliance officer with the pre-release in Great Falls and is trying to get into the Army Reserve, so she'll be in the, and her dream is to be a probation officer. So she had to deal with this. It was hard on her, actually. She had to deal with this while dealing with these people that are doing the same thing. And they would say, and it was just hard for her to, and I hope she does become a probation officer, because I think she'll be good at it because of the experience going through it. And actually, two of her coworkers are working for Family Services in Great Falls right now. And they actually work with her all through this October. So I think they got to see the other side of it through Christina. So I think they might have two good employees there.
And Rachel Zins is not in
prison. Rachel Zins now is the social worker at Missouri River Manor Nursing Home taking care of our other helpless, the old folks.
Lovely.
Right. Okay.
Sorry, let me write that down. Sounds like a place I ought to go. Rachel Zins is working where?
At Missouri River Manor Nursing Home.
And where is that?
In Great Falls. As a social worker. And, yeah.
Have any reporters been able to interview her?
No. Actually, they tried just this last week when they were doing that article that's in the paper now, a year, or, yeah. And apparently they never got to, because I didn't see anything mentioned of her in there. Yeah.
Well, I'm definitely going to call her and tell her she's going to be one of the stars of the movie. So
yeah.
If she'd like to comment, or if she just wants to let us tell her story.
Right.
How old a person, describe Rachel Zins to us. Appearance, age, education, if you know.
I really don't know what her education, she's got, I don't know what you have to have a degree in social work, I'm
driver's
thinking.
License.
Well, that could be. I think she's got a degree in social work. And I think she's probably in her late 20s, I would say.
Married?
She was. She's divorced now.
Yes. kids.
And ironically, through all this, while my sister and I met with her, and she had all of her nice little stuff. She was nursing her baby, and all the things to extract the breast milk were sitting there, right there in her office while we were... So she had a baby. So she should... while this was all going on, just a young... Yeah, and my sister actually worked with her, because my sister worked at Missouri River Manor for a while, because she actually worked there prior, Rachel Zins did, and then she got the job with Family Services and worked there, and then they hired her back after this to Missouri River as the social worker there. Yeah.
So she has at least one child.
Yep. Yep. And
know whether the people responsible for protecting children have gone into her home to check the situation?
I have no idea. I don't know.
They should.
Well, I would think. I would think. The whole thing, you know, I could see them not believing me if there wasn't all this evidence. I could believe, you know, oh, you're just telling stories because you're in this custody thing and you just want custody of your granddaughter. But when we have broken bones, missing teeth, pulled out hair, bruises all the time, and in fact, the bruising she always had was on her forehead, and it was always in different places. And in the redacted Family Services records we have, you could read that part that the lady, because that was one of the issues I said, she was always full of bruises, and the mother's excuse was she would bump her head on the counter. Well, right in the Family Services notes, it says that she observed October ducking every time she went near the counter. Right.
We know she didn't bump her head on any counters.
Right, right.
Rachel Zins, Caucasian?
Yes, yep. Yep, she is.
All right. I understand some other social workers have recently commented for the newspaper.
Right.
Can you tell me about that?
All I know is they just said that it wouldn't have happened on their watch or... I firmly believe, personally, if I could have had the social worker, her name was Carrie, I can't recall her last name, the night at the emergency room, if she would have stayed on the case, unfortunately she was just the on-call worker, I think we would have had a different outcome. I really do. And I will always believe that. It was just, like I said, Rachel Zins just... It was like her word was the law, and no matter how we tried to get her to listen, she wasn't gonna, because she'd made her decision.
Was there, the Hyslop, did he have any money? Now, apparently not living in those conditions.
You know what always, and it still haunts me to this day, the day I met him, he has pain, P-A-I-N, tattooed on one hand, and F-U-C-K on the other hand. So who would tattoo pain on their hand if they didn't mean it for the whole world to see anywhere you went?
And would Rachel Zins supposedly sit down and interview with him?
Yes, she did. She interviewed him, the brother, and Janetta, the brother's girlfriend. Yes, they had an interview.
And was he, you know, if he was wearing gloves?
I'm sure he wasn't. I never ever saw him. So she would see that.
You can miss it, right?
Right. You can't, because that pop, I mean, that was one of the first things I saw on him when I met him, the day I met him. And he had his children taken away in the state of Oklahoma. Family Services took his children away.
Did Rachel Zins know that?
We told her that, and I don't know if she ever checked or...
want to work you up to another sound bite.
Okay.
My only granddaughter was murdered, despite the fact that for months and months and months, I and others brought this to the attention of the people in Great Falls, Montana, who were supposed to be in the business of protecting children. She had broken bones that were never treated, teeth knocked out, bruises all over her body, hair missing. She was living with a man who we told the social worker had his children taken away from him previously in another state. He had the words pain tattooed on one of his hands, the word F-U-C-K tattooed on his other knuckles. Is that
what right, on his knuckles.
The conditions in which my granddaughter was forced to live could only be described as worse than horrific. Living in squalor next to an open flame on a broken makeshift bed next to a drain in which people urinated with feces on the floor in the basement of a tiny house.
Yeah.
And the social workers claimed they went and looked at all this, and it was in the best interest of the child to remain in that home. And a few months later, she was murdered.
Yeah,
that puts all the horrible stuff in one fell swoop. So can you,
well,
I hate to make you relive that, but can you try to, you know, that's the kind of thing that we'll want to put as a soundbite in the movie.
Oh, okay, if I can remember all that.
Well, you lived through it all, so just what you're wanting to do is paint the full picture of the horrors that they ignored and what happened in one horrible statement. Just the best you can.
Do you want me, do you say my name again, or just into the...
Just talk about it.
Okay. So my only granddaughter, October, died at the hands of a man who had his children taken away in the state of Oklahoma, who had pain tattooed on one knuckle and F-U-C-K on the other knuckles. After we reported teeth, hair, bruises, and autopsy reports with horrific back-breaking, two back breaks, bruises all over her, broken toes, in a house that was not big enough for six people and two dogs, that was so filthy. The reporter, the court, I think it was a police officer who did the filming at the time of her death, called it repulsive and just about couldn't finish filming in it. It stunk so bad. October slept on a broken bed frame with a ripped mattress with no sheet beside an open flame furnace in front of a washer.
in your opinion, and you should preface your response with that, in your opinion, what should happen to Rachel Zins?
I believe she should be prosecuted.
And my voice isn't heard, remember, so I'll start over.
Okay, I believe Rachel Zins, the caseworker, should be prosecuted for, I don't know what, if endangerment for children, neglecting her duties, I don't know what they could, it's a felony anyway, there was a death. I can't see, and instead she moves on and is a social worker at a nursing home for more helpless people. We got babies and old folks. And now she's a social worker there. She just moved on with her life. Our baby's dead. She moved on.
Rachel Zins has absolutely no business being involved in social work of any type. I think she ought to be prosecuted for aiding and abetting in murder. I don't know if there's even a cause of action for that.
I don't know.
If not, why don't we establish one real quick?
There is.
There is?
There is.
Do you have a picture of Rachel Zins?
No, I don't.
Have you ever sent one online or anything?
I've never seen one.
She probably got a Facebook page.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know if there is one or not. Well, the way I look at it, all of them, including the mother, Kendall Hyslop, the brother, and his girlfriend, Janetta, when you drive somebody to a store and they decide to rob it, you get in trouble whether you knew about it or not. But you can let a baby get beat to death and just walk away and carry on with your life. No looking back.
This is one of the only cases where I wish that Montana had the felony murder rule. Florida has the felony murder rule. One of the young men that we're going to be interviewing is spending, since he was 19, he's been in prison for life without mm-hmm. the possibility of parole because he loaned his car to an acquaintance who then committed murder. And under the Florida felony murder rule, if you're with someone, they commit murder, you're guilty of murder. Or if you loan your car to someone and they commit murder, you're guilty of murder. This boy was at home, asleep in bed, when this acquaintance, not even a friend, committed a murder. And he's in prison for life without the possibility of parole because it's a law in Florida.
And the law in Montana is, there's a law, it's public duty doctrine, I believe is how they named it. We can't even go back and sue family services or anything because they're protected. They can basically write their own ticket. They can do what they want. And there's no repercussions for them.
Gotta be a way around that.
Okay, what they told me, we consulted a lawyer. If you can prove that Rachel Zins and the mother or the Hyslops or the girlfriend had some kind of
conspiracy,
yeah, then you can do it. But why should I have to prove that when all the records prove what they did?
42 U.S.C. 1983 is a statute you ought to look at. It's a violation of civil rights. I mean, obviously, the child's civil rights were violated, that your rights were
right.
violated. That's one. There is it's federal, so I don't know that it would apply, probably doesn't apply. There's a federal statute relative to the obligation to perform your duties properly.
Right.
Of course, the trouble is you never find a judge that will do anything
right
about it. But in your case, if you could get before a judge and a jury, you should be able to win.
That's just, yeah.
You're not going to win anything you want.
No.
You only want one thing, and you can't have that.
Right.
But I can sure see how, if I was in your shoes,
yeah.
I would want somebody to be punished any way I could get them
yes.
punished.
Yes. because I really don't believe in lawsuits, but in this case, because of the fact they're all walking away, and like I said, unless possibly they told me there's more investigations, but I'm not supposed to talk about it. Of course, I don't know anything about it. So,
how many people involved do you have pictures of? You have a picture, I'm sure, of Christy.
Yep, and we have, I think. Not in there.
We have Hyslop, I'm sure.
Yes, where's the one that, the pictures? I think there's pictures of all of them in the paper, actually, of Hyslop, both Hyslops. They called them High Slope during the trial, but I was introduced them as Hyslop.
For our purpose, it's Slop.
Me too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's a picture of Hyslop. There's several pictures of Hyslop. And I believe there's a picture of the mother and the county attorney hugging the mother, no less. I tell you, the whole town was repulsed by that picture. Everybody I talked to was like, what the hell was he thinking, hugging that mother?
Hold on.
Yeah, we've got them in the... Yeah, here's the mother and the grandma right here.
Why don't we do this? Yeah. I'd like to have, if they're newspaper, do you have the pictures of October in JPEGs or any kind of electronic file?
My son does. Yeah, my son does.
Could he email?
But
those
I don't.
Or put them on a disk. Or
I don't know if he has those ones from the funeral home on it.
You can always scan the ones that are here and put them on a disk really easy.
Yeah. I would definitely like to get pictures. I don't know how many I'll be able to use, but I'd like to have some to choose from. What I'd like to have you do is take a really good picture of October.
Uh-huh.
I'd like to have you hold it up. And then I'd like you to take a picture of it.
Here's the one with her lips cut. That's a cute picture, but her face is, she's got bruises and her lips are cut. That picture on the front of that is the poster child in the state of Montana. Everybody knows who October is in Montana. Because, you know, you asked me, I guess, about how we got it so public. It was when I was in New York City, when my daughter up at the hospital called my brother, who lived in Chicago, and he knew what we had, the fighting, we were trying to get her out of there, and he immediately called the TV station in Great Falls and said, hey, there's a baby laying up at that hospital right now, and the story's bigger than you think. And that is how it went.
Yeah, that's the only time they're interested is when
somebody right. dies. Yeah, isn't that terrible?
Yeah.
That's terrible. Yeah, that is terrible.
They'll cover a situation with a judge if he buys drugs for his stripper girlfriend. And,
yeah.
And the FBI does a sting for him buying $160 worth of drugs.
Right, right.
But if he takes billions of dollars from people and ruins right. lives left and right, and they don't right. cover it.
Right.
It's just horrible. All right, well, I'd like you to hold up the poster child picture.
Which one's that one?
Right there. It does. You can finish looking at it because it comes out.
All right.
She's actually wearing my son's boots. This is when he was home in January on leave, and one of my friends.
I'm going to stop you.
Okay.
I want you to do introduce the photo in full because we will actually drop the photo in over you.
Okay.
What I'd like you to do is lift it up.
How?
Just a sec. I zoomed out. I don't want to go back in. All right. Now, when I point, introduce the photo. Tell us who it is.
Okay.
What she's wearing.
Okay.
When this was taken.
Okay.
And then we'll drop the actual photo in over the screen.
Okay. This is my granddaughter, October. We call it In Daddy's Boots because this is when he was home on leave in January of 2011. And she loved to wear everybody's shoes. And my friend who does for a living. She does the advertising things for me. She removed the background and put the blue ribbon for child abuse and forget-me-not flowers on the ribbon. And pretty much the whole state of Montana knows this because this was distributed when we did a petition to get things changed in the legislature to hopefully to make it easier on families who are fighting with family services to get action taken. So this is October, the poster child of child abuse.
Continue to hold it, if you will.
Okay.
You get quiet a second, I'll get in just tight on her face. Sweet pie.
Okay, we've actually been working with the legislators. They have the interim committee for Health and Human Services. Since October passed away, we passed around a petition in the whole state and got over thousands of signatures. We're trying to get, right now in the state of Montana, if you make a call to intake, they call it, for child abuse, they don't know there's been other calls made on that child because every call is treated as it's a new call, and they didn't know you called 10 times or 15 people have called. So they're supposed to get a new computer system, and we also, for an ombudsman through the justice, he won't be affiliated with the justice, but that's the department he'll be. So when people have problems like this, you have somebody to go to. And also to get the caseworkers certified. And so family fathers, mothers, grandmothers, aunts, mandatory reporters that are fighting for children can have a look at the records with family services to see if they're actually doing anything. And actually, it was just last Monday we were here in Helena at the Capitol, and all three of them went through. They're going to be introduced as bills, and the new computer system, Sarah Corbley is supposed to put that in her budget. So now we have to keep track of that and see if that is actually going to happen. Because like I said, they tell you what you want to hear. They all tell you what you want to hear.
October's laws.
Right. We hope. Yeah. So hopefully that goes through. So.
Now you've had media coverage.
Oh, yeah.
Could you show us the newspaper story that's just come out? Do you have it there?
Yeah, I have it here somewhere. Do I have it here? Yep, right here. Yeah. I have all of them actually in a book. This is the one that came out yesterday in the Great Falls Tribune. It's my daughter and I here, and my granddaughter, October. And it's the death of October Perez, change or out of tragedy. A little over a year later, they took a look back to see how we were doing and if anything's changed, and talked to some caseworkers.
Is this on the front page?
This is the front page of the Great Falls Tribune. This one is from Sunday, the Sunday paper. Yep. Yes. And there's actually, this is my, actually, I would love it if you went and looked at the back of my car to see what I've done. I know there's a few people in the town of Great Falls, I can't name names, that aren't appreciative of it, but this repulses everybody. This is the county attorney hugging the mother that was taken after David Hyslop was found guilty, and they put it back in the paper. Every person I talk to that has seen this, the first go around in it back when the trial was going on, were like, how could he hug that mother? And this is at my house, actually, the memorial service, we had a private one at my house, and this is my son. And this is my blown up picture of the poster child with background still on it. Yeah. So we have.
So in order to get coverage in the mainstream media of the problems with corruption and
right.
incompetence in our various government agencies, it takes
a tragedy
to be murdered.
Right.
You want to talk about that? What do you think of the media's refusal, it seems, to cover stories about corruption and incompetence and abuse by government and government agencies?
I've found through all this, it's not only the media. It's nobody wants to talk about child abuse. It's like a taboo subject. Nobody wants to hear it. And like I told Cleve, and I always tell everybody, that child abuse is, it can't be sugar-coated because it's real and it happens. And people just don't want to hear about it. They don't want to talk about it. It's a terrible thing. And like it takes a tragedy. And the sad part of the tragedy is this tragedy didn't have to happen. There was too much evidence against what was going on with her. I just, like one of the potential jurors said, I like what she said. She said she just can't wrap her head around a 2-year-old deserving this. And needless to say, she didn't get picked for jury duty. And I think that perfectly describes it. You can't wrap your head around a child deserving this. I really do.
Tell us about October.
October. We had fun with little October. Well, she loved the snow, absolutely loved the snow. The sound of the crunch under her snow boots. She loved it. Well, actually, John Parker told me at one of our meetings that for her, it must have been like going to Disneyland when I took her home, because she had a clean house, room to play. She had her toys. She rode her little, I had one of those little plastic Barbie trikes, and she just rode it in the house. And he said it must have been like Disneyland for her to go to your house. She got fed. She had a clean place to sleep. She had toys, because I know her mother told me there were no toys there at the house, and try to buy some. But unfortunately, in most of these cases like this, when you buy the children things, you have to actually take it out of the package and everything, so they can't take it back to the store for money, I discovered. But October, she loved to play. I have a golden retriever, and they fought over the toys because I had it in a basket, and October decided that was her basket, but the dog knew it was her basket with her toys in it. So they fought all the time over that. And when my daughter would be vacuuming and things, she would wear headphones, and October would see that, and she'd run up to her and want up, and she'd rip it out of her ear and put it in hers and then start dancing to her music. So she liked that. She loved to take baths. And as I found out later, at her house, that wasn't possible in a black shower. Her toys. She loved, she had 3 little rubber duckies. One was a Santa Claus, and one was just a regular rubber ducky. And she always put them in the seat of her little tricycle and pushed them around. And she had building blocks she played with. She watched TV a little bit, but she really didn't have time. She would rather be busy riding her trike and things than watching TV. But she was a happy, for what she lived, she was the happiest child, you know. But you could always tell when I was going to bring her home. It was somehow, she must have knew on Sunday nights it was time to go, because I would change her back into her clothes she came in, but I had washed them, and she knew, and she'd just change, you know. You could just tell. She's like, oh, you know, I'm leaving Disneyland and going back to the hellhole.
Did she talk much?
No, she didn't talk a whole lot. I was working on that because there was no interaction. The mother wasn't a mother. I think her main thing was it was her welfare check with the kids. Because that was one of her things. She told me right away from the get-go when I was trying to get things legal. No, we won't do it legal. You can just give me money. I said, oh, no, lady. We have a lawyer and we'll do it legally.
Did October have a name for you?
No. No, she didn't say too many words. She said my cat's name, but only my cat is Kaylee, and she called her Wee Wee. And she didn't even know how to blow kisses when I first had her. I taught her how, and she should have known that. She had no interaction with her. And every time I brought her, she knew something new, and her mother, out of the blue, she'd do this. It's like, no, we sit and read books, and we sit and talk, and like you're supposed to do.
Had you chosen a grandma's name?
No, I just called her I just called myself grandma to her. Come on, let's go with grandma. And we called my daughter auntie. But she could say daddy, because before my son was deployed, we went to a yellow ribbon ceremony, and they had these neat books. They were made out, and one was a man, and one was a female book. And in the back, you put a picture, and it was to sit and read to the child while the parent, I mean, they were designed for probably 3, 4 and under kids. So you could read, and it told, when you see the moon, daddy sees the same moon kind of things. Daddy brushes his teeth there. Daddy does this there, just like you do here. And then in the back, there was a place for a picture. So we would be reading that, and we'd get to the back, and she'd always say, daddy, when she got to the back. So she could say that. And
but you never got to hear your granddaughter call you grandma?
Nope. I never did get to hear her call me grandma. Nope. So it's sad. And like I keep saying, it didn't have to happen. It's the saddest part of it all. It did not have to happen.
There are millions of mothers and grandmothers and fathers and grandfathers out there who don't have a clue about this. What would you say to them?
I really encourage people to learn about child abuse, because like myself, this is the kind of things you hear about in the paper or read about in the paper and think, oh my God, that poor family, and then you move on. We got to be that poor family. And it's terrible. We had to explain to, I come from a huge family. There's 14 children in my family, so I have like 28 nieces and nephews and 40 some greats. And we had to explain to little kids, how could somebody do that? And how do you tell a child that there's evil people out there that do this to children?
And that there are people in position to protect, right, and don't do anything about it.
And there's people, yeah, there's people that could have prevented it and did nothing. Yep.
Do we have any questions from the audience?
I would like to know if judge ever heard about any of these complaints before October died?
I don't believe they had, because like I said, the county attorney told me that they never heard anything about October till the 23rd, when she was beaten and at the hospital.
Just amazes me. Absolutely amazes me. They pull kids out, strip them from their families, and they don't pull kids out who need to be protected. I'm just dumbfounded by it.
That's the part you know, I can see they probably do have people calling just trying to get custody of a child. But like I said before, when there's all this evidence of broken bones and teeth missing and hair missing, and what is ironic about that, only like a week later, after October passed away, there was another child that was reported, the boyfriend apparently pulled her hair out and her tooth, and they immediately removed her from the home. But that was after my granddaughter died.
Yeah, I wanted to take a death.
Right.
So she is going to keep some other people, other children alive.
I hope.
Do you know where her organs
are? I don't know where the organs went. I would like to find out, but like I said, we put in orders with the court on July 28th for all the records, and we still have not gotten them. And hopefully this week we will find something out about that. Yeah, because really, we don't know what all happened to her. I do know, however, the expert they had come, Katie Wells, I believe was her name. She's from Colorado. That testified. She's an expert on child abuse, one of the top 10 in the country, is what they say. She said that was the worst back break they had ever seen. The second one, not the first one, the second one that actually on the 23rd, not the one that happened a week or two prior.
And DFS goes in this house 3 times a week.
3 hours a week. 1 day, 3 hours a week. And there's pot plants, the filth. And I know they couldn't have gone and checked to see where those kids slept, because that would have never been approved. That would have never been by the flames of a furnace and a water heater right in front of the washer and dryer over a sewer drain and all that filth.
I mean, knowing that these guys are supposed to be immune, you know, there is a case where one lady was handicapped and they said, well, you can't take care of your baby. You're
right.
In a wheelchair. That guy, that lawyer sued him and they won. So there's got to be a way to do something.
Yeah. It's just, it just makes you sick. Yeah, every day. There's not a day that goes by that you don't think about it. Not a day.
I have 2 granddaughters.
Mm-hmm.
Who I told them the other day on the phone, I said, I couldn't love you anymore if I tried. It's just not possible.
Right. Well, they do fill a place in your heart. Your kids don't. And I don't know how you explain it.
I know.
Yeah. And they do, don't they?
Because your kids are all grown up. Yeah, I know.
Yeah.
October will be in the movie.
Okay.
Will be in the movie. This is absolutely one of the stories that we have to tell in the movie. And I'm so glad you came. How did you find out about it? About me, was it Mark, or did you?
Actually, Cleve Loney, our legislator from District 25 in Great Falls, he hooked up with us immediately when this happened, because he's been doing a lot for child abuse. And he asked us a long time ago about it. And
maybe we should ask her about that, the 180 politicians that got invited to Memorial, who showed up?
Yeah, 180 politicians were invited to come to the memorial service out at my house. It was a private one I had myself. The other side of the family, of course, wasn't involved. Well, they haven't done anything about child abuse, nothing. And he was the only one that showed up. We got one letter from the lieutenant governor. And Cleve showed up.
So, you invited, who did you invite?
Actually, I didn't, it was Lisa Stroh. She is related by marriage. My sister, she's my sister-in-law's sister, and she actually has been fighting with family services. She is the superintendent of school for Blaine County. And she had been fighting a long time with family services over some children she had reported on. And she told them, she had just, I have the letter, but I don't have it with me. Anyway, she wrote them a letter, family services, and said, let's try to get some of this done before there's going to be a tragedy. And my sister-in-law called her and told her it was October, and she's like, oh my God, you know, it's somebody up close and personal that it happened to.
So governor, lieutenant governor, every member of the House, did a House and a Senate or an Assembly here?
I'm not sure who all she sent the letter to. I just know there was a lot of them sent, and Cleve was the one that came. Yep.
Cleve told me personally that there was 180 invited, and he was the only one that showed up.
Yep.
And a session wasn't going on.
No, because it was in July, the beginning of July, right before the 4th of July. Yeah, actually.
They were probably all in can or something.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, because we actually had that on July 3rd, that memorial, because they kind of were fighting over the body because the defense wanted to do their own autopsy. So it was a court fight to get her body back here.
So who was it, Jensen, that...
I don't know who was the...
I know you guys went through a boulder and he gave you a $750,000 bail bond, right?
Yeah.
And, let's see.
Judge Masick was the judge, and she did a wonderful job. She did. That was... it's... when we went for his sentencing...
Are you still filming, Bill?
I am.
When we went for his sentencing... for David Hyslop's sentencing, we got to read our statements, the victim statements and stuff, and then Julie Masick told him, we're going to sentence you to 100 years, and we kept waiting because the county attorney said he's going for without the possibility of parole, so we wouldn't have to go back ever so many years and relive it. But then she stopped at that, and then she went into at least a 5-minute spiel telling him off. There was no remorse. He showed no remorse. He didn't turn around and say, I'm sorry for what I... No remorse whatsoever. And then she told him off, including that you went downstairs and took a nap or cuddled or whatever they said. And after she was done with her spiel, then she said, and that is why I'm sentencing you without the possibility of parole.
I like that.
Yep.
Look, could I see the pictures, the photos?
A lot of people thought we were morbid doing that, but...
I don't think so.
No. You got to have
not
it.
Under the circumstances.
Yeah.
See, what's weird is that we have a fight where CPS has too much power.
Right.
And then we have a fight where they say they need more power because of instances like this. I mean, that's how hard this is.
Right.
Because
I actually drew up a plan to help fix this problem 4 years ago, and some of the top officials say, great ideas.
Yeah.
You just need more money for funding, something
right.
like that.
Yeah.
It has to be their
May
idea.
I pull a few of these out for you to hold up?
Sure.
You'll know where to put them back.
Yeah, we'll figure it out. No problem.
I got a DUI and they took my teenagers away out of my home and handed them over to two felons, and one was a felon for child abuse.
See, that's another thing. I actually went and took the classes with family services to be a foster home. Mm-hmm. And I got my certificate. I got all the paperwork in. And this was in May before October was killed. And all they had to do was inspect my home, and I have never heard from them. And they were crying for foster homes.
They still are.
Right. And that's all they had to do was come and inspect my home. And for me to have that emergency custody of her, I had to go get fingerprinted and a background check. My 84-year-old mother lives between my sister and I, and she would have had to have a background check and fingerprinted, but none of those people in that house had
to. Isn't that interesting? I find the same thing.
Yep.
It's unbelievable. And then all the paperwork that entails, questionnaires, like,
yep.
Such as, and this is one of their questionnaires, and their little questionnaire booklets are about that thick. What was your first sexual experience like? And were you angry? Did you feel upset? Were you happy? Were you sad? I'm thinking, wow, are you kidding me?
Well, I have another interesting thing.
Where is it? You know how I felt with my first sexual experience.
Yeah.
It's kind of like...
It's very intrusive.
It is intrusive. And it's almost like a lot of the questions they ask is, do you still beat your wife? No, I don't still beat her.
Oh, 10 times a day.
They ask the question.
I got to find that.
Either way, you lose with the answer.
This is all my mess and notes.
When they do background checks for people, you know, when a family member gets their kids taken away, they do background checks on these people. Well, one will come back really quick, but another one will take months and months and months to drag it on so the kid can go somewhere over here, and then they'll adopt them out because that background check never came in.
Right, because now they're allowed, a certain amount of time?
Okay, I have their legal definitions because... Unfortunately for them, I have their book now because I got it during that training. And in their legal definitions of abuse and neglect, out of their pre-service training book, it states causes malnutrition or failure to thrive or otherwise fails to supply the child with adequate food or fails to supply clothing, shelter, education, or adequate health care. Though financially able to do so or offered financial or reasonable means to do so. October was on Medicaid, and I offered that caseworker to pay for the medical care. And then it exposes or allows the child to be exposed to an unreasonable risk at the child's health or welfare by failing to intervene or eliminate the risk. And both of those happened in that. Because actually, in the redacted part of the family services thing I have, it's marked that there's impending danger.
We spend, in Washington, we spend many, many, many thousands of hours with group of us all over the state.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Not filth, but just a messy clutter here, clutter there. You know, just from not having kids, yeah. You get cluttered. You can't be picking
right.
Up.
Well, I explained that to the county attorney because he said something about the messy house. I said, oh, no. I said, I've been cleaning houses for a living with my cleaning business for 20 years. I said, there's a difference between a messy house and a filthy house. Mm-hmm. I said, there is a difference. Yeah, repulsive is how they explain it.
Can I see that album?
Yes.
That's not a photo album. That's just all the stories. Newspaper article.
That's the, yeah.
A bunch of them.
All right, then let's work with these if we could. I have these kind of in an order, and I would like you to hold them up one at a time and tell me about them.
Can we sneak out real quick?
You can sneak out.
Thank you.
If you will, hold them right up next to your face when you do it, because and tilt them kind of down. Cause
like that?
Tilt it maybe even slightly a little bit more the other way. The
this top. Way?
Yeah, because that way we'll keep a shine off of them. All right, so we're rolling, so you want to tell me about
this one? Okay, this one was taken at a fast food place because we made sure and got up, and you can see the bruises and a slap mark on her cheek and... It was actually on her ear also. I believe that was at her brother's birthday in December of 2010. And this is when we got to go over and see her when her mother lived in the government housing, who, by the way, was kicked out of government housing for drugs. This is out at my house. The way the wind blows, I get 4-foot snow drifts. And October already loved the snow to hear it crunch. And I didn't have a snow pants for her, but I had this from her Halloween, and it worked perfect. It's a Care Bear suit. And she'd put that on, and she would go cruising up and down those snowbanks. And she would just have a ball. She didn't care how cold it was either. It was all. In fact, she'd get mad at us when we would bring her in. And this picture always bothered me, and I'll tell you why. It's beautiful. She looks like a little angel. And that's why it bothered me, because I looked at it when we got it back, and I said, oh, my God, she looks like she died. She was dead in this picture. And unfortunately, just a few months later, we got to listen to the gruesome pictures where she actually was. And that is on her second birthday. I had it at my house.
That was her last birthday.
That was her last birthday, on her second birthday. And oh boy, did she have fun. She had fun. And this is right a day or two after. My son actually arrived home from Afghanistan the day after October's birthday. And this was right around then, or a day or two later, October sitting on his lap, and they were doing something with the computer. Oops. And this is one we got from October's half-brother's daddy that he thought was funny. And she actually had a pair of one of her great-grandmother's glasses on. But this one is the one where my sister saw it and decided that definitely is Michael's daughter, because if I had a picture of him when he was in grade school, back then they had those bigger glasses, and she looks just like him in that one. And this is right after her birthday. One of my friend's son had a birthday party, and she wasn't used to just having free rein with food, and I just unwrapped her cupcake and gave it to her, and literally she just, the whole thing in her mouth at once, and her hands were filthy and her face was filthy. She didn't know what to do, but she enjoyed that cupcake. And this is one of the her grandmother snuck her out to see me, because I wasn't allowed to see her there, her other grandma. And she's riding her bike, had her toys all over the place with my mother's hat and gloves on, because she loved other people's stuff. She didn't care. She'd take it and put it on. And this is her taking a bath with her broken arm, with a bag over her broken arm, in February. Oops. And this is in February with a little shirt my daughter got her that said Army, with her broken arm, laying on the couch. She was a little cutie. And this is the last time we got to see her after she passed away. Broken and bruised.
You can see the bruises.
Yeah, they had, she looked like a porcelain doll. You could see thick makeup all over her, but you can see the bruises through the makeup. Her whole inside of her ear was bruises all over her. Both legs, both arms, full of bruises. It just makes you sick. I don't even know. I will never understand how a person can do this to a child. Never. No child deserves this. No child deserves that. This is a album where I kept track of all the newspaper articles throughout the last year and a half or so. After October passed away, all the articles of her and the articles that they interviewed Family Services, trying to figure out what went wrong, how we could fix it. And all the way through the trial of David Hyslop. It's just a book. So we would never have to try to remember what happened, what like we'll ever forget. But I hope to one day make a copy of this book and give it to October's half-brother. So when he has questions, he can find some of the answers he's looking for.
Okay, any final words?
My final words to anybody would be, even if you think something's happening to a child, whether it's your child, your grandchild, somebody else's child, your neighbor's child, don't just sit back. You have to try as hard as you can to make a call and get somebody to listen. And if you're the mother and you think somebody's doing to your child, get them out of that situation immediately. If at all possible, remove them or report it to authorities, and don't shut up. Don't ever, ever, ever be quiet. Don't let them tell you to be quiet. That's my advice.
Ask you about your son.
Okay.
How has this affected him? How has he reacted to it? What's he doing these days?
My son is, he's in the Army Reserve still. And, okay.
Bill Windsor? Yes, sir? Just send them on up to the room. Anybody who comes, you can just send on up. Oh, okay. This morning they said they could, so it's changed, huh? Yeah. The general manager was there, so I think it's okay. 206. Thanks. The manager said it was okay.
My son, fortunately, he didn't have to live through all this like I did. And I think a lot of times he didn't realize how serious it was. So he had to live it through the court when he learned all the details, and when they did the trial, he sat through the trial every day. And like I said, it's just horrific. It's just, to this, I think to this day we still, it's like unreal. It's because of the fact you can't imagine somebody doing this. And it's just accepting the fact. I don't know if it's because of him being in Iraq and Afghanistan, or he just doesn't feel like he can talk about it. He doesn't talk about it a whole bunch with other people, but we will. We will sit down and talk about it. But he doesn't talk about a lot of things with other people, because I think that's just the way they get when they're dealing with that, because they all have post-traumatic. And this actually is that too. We're all suffering from it now. I don't know if he'll ever have more children, but if he does, if that happens, I can guarantee you they will be protected with his life. Unfortunately, a lot of cases your hands are tied, and we tried, he tried, and he just doesn't like to talk about it a whole bunch. So a lot of, most of the things, myself as the grandmother, I'm making it, getting it out there. But he has to, of course, do the legal end, because he's the dad. But I think he's going to start participating more now that the trial's over. And he did learn what happened. You know, it wasn't coming from me. He learned the facts. And hopefully, within the next week or so, we'll get the rest of them, and we'll never shut up. We'll never be quiet about it. Never, 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 never.
You can come in.
Well, you got a whole hallway